Hallelujah. Glory to God. 6 p.m. West African time, 17 hours GMT. It's time for church on the waves. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Every praise is to our God. Tell someone to tell someone to tell someone. Get in touch with someone. Let someone know that church on the waves is on. God is said to do great and mighty things tonight, and I believe his name shall be glorified in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We want to give every praise to our God. We want to return all the glory and all the praise to him for all that he has been doing in our lives, and then as a ministry, and then all the testimonies, good news that we have been receiving on Church on the Waves. We return every glory, every praise, every adoration, and every worship to our God tonight. Let's praise him together. Every praise. Hallelujah. It's to our God, everyone that worships, the one I call. Every praise, every praise. It's to our God. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To our God, glory, hallelujah. To our God, every praise, every praise is to our God. God, my Savior, God, my healer, God, my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. God, my Savior. God, my healer. God, my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. God, my Savior. God, my healer. God, my deliverer. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Every praise is to our God. Everyone who worships with one accord. Every praise, every praise. Worship with one accord. Every praise and every praise is to our God. Hallelujah. You are welcome to Church on the Waves. God is said to do something awesome in your life today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I would like you to get in touch with your friends. Start a watch party. Let someone know that Church on the Waves is on. God is said to do great and mighty things tonight, and I believe your life and my life will be a living testimony of tonight's broadcast. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I say good morning, a good afternoon, and a good evening to you, wherever you are on the planet Earth. I want you to know that God has something mighty in store for you today, and you will not miss your portion in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, the entrance of thy word giveth light and giveth understanding to the simple. I believe, God, that there will be an entrance of his word tonight into every heart. It will give light, and every darkness will disappear in every life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. It will give light. It will give understanding to every simple heart today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Light will shine upon your path today. You will no longer stumble. You will no longer fall. you will no longer fail in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. The Bible says he sent his word. I'm believing God tonight. God is sending his word into your life. God is sending his word into your situation. God is sending his word into your destiny. And I believe God that his word will heal tonight. His word will liberate and deliver from every form of destruction. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Can we say a word of prayer together? Father, we just bless your name. What a joy to see another broadcast of Church on the Waves. We appreciate you for all the testimonies, the great and mighty things that you have been doing via this platform. We return every praise, every adoration, every glory, every commendation, Lord, we return to you, Lord, to this hour. Receive them all in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I release myself to you this hour as I take over my tongue and my lips. Cause me to speak as oracle and to minister with the ability that you give in the name of Jesus Christ. Let utterance be given to me tonight, Lord. Cause everyone to hear me speak in their own language in the name of Jesus Christ. I lean on your grace tonight to deliver your heartbeat, to deliver your counsel, Lord, to everyone under the sound of my voice at this hour in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. As I to remember the covenant that you honor your word and that you cause your name to be glorified. Thank you, mighty God. We give you the glory and we give you the praise. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. Once again, you are welcome to Church on the Waves. Once again, tell someone to tell someone to tell someone that Church on the Waves is on. It's going to be awesome tonight. I'm believing God and resting on his grace to be able to deliver his heartbeat to you. You know, the Holy Spirit woke me up this morning and we had a wonderful time together. He gave me a message for you. He gave me a message for someone out there. And, you know, when I was rounding up as it were this morning, I said, Lord, just give me the grace to be able to deliver this message the same way you're giving it to me, to share it with someone out there today. I believe God for utterance tonight, and I believe that your life will be graciously imparted. You will never be the same again in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want to take my text tonight. I'll be sharing with you. Thank you everyone who has joined us from all over the world, from Canada, from the UK, from Sweden, from everywhere. Thank you for joining us from Nigeria, definitely. Thank you for joining us. I would like you to invite someone, call someone, let someone know that Church on the Waves is on. It's going to be awesome tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. I welcome every one of you, and I believe God's word will do something great in your life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want to share with you briefly today something that the Holy Ghost laid upon my heart. I want to read a text from the Bible. Genesis 37. I want to show you two contrasts. I want to show you two contrasts, and that is where we are going to take off from at this hour on Church on the Waves. Genesis 37 from verse 26. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. And Judah said unto his brethren, what profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood? Come, and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him. For he is our brother and our flesh. And his brethren were content. That is, they agreed. Verse 28, then there passed by Midianites, merchant men. I don't think this is a coincidence. But there passed by Midianites, merchant men. And they drew and lifted up Joseph out of the pit and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they brought Joseph into Egypt. They sold Joseph for 20 pieces of silver, and the Ishmaelites brought Joseph into Egypt. That is one side. Let me show you another side. Genesis, the same Genesis chapter 49. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Genesis 49. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Genesis 49. I'll be reading much of the scripture today from verse 1. And Jacob, Genesis 45. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Genesis 45 from verse 1. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all of them that stood by him. And he cried, cause every man to go out from me. And there stood no man with him, while Joseph made himself known unto his brethren. And he wept aloud. And the Egyptians and the house of Pharaoh heard. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph. And doth my father yet live? And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. I pray for someone today, the testimony that will shock you to your bones, the testimony that will leave you speechless, the breakthrough that will leave you speechless is coming your way this hour in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Receive it now in the name of Jesus Christ. His brothers could not answer him. Oh, God will surprise someone today. God will shock you to your bones in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. His brothers could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. And Joseph said unto his brethren, come near to me, I pray you. And they came near and they said, I am Joseph. This is the second time I was telling them. They couldn't believe that it was the same Joseph. Oh, sorry, it's not the same Joseph anymore. Hallelujah. I pray for someone today. God will use you to surprise your world. God will use you to shock your world. People who have known you before to be someone will be surprised at who God is making out of you this hour in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And Joseph said unto them, come near to me, I pray. And they came near and he said, I'm your Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. Hallelujah. Now therefore, be not grieved nor angry with yourselves that you sold me here, for God did send me before you to preserve your life. For these 2 years, there has been famine in the land. And yet there are 5 years in which there shall neither be hearing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you as a posterity in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Hallelujah. The Bible says the stone that was rejected has now become the chief cornerstone. I pray for someone under the sound of my voice today, where you have been despised, where you have been rejected, God will turn you to the chief cornerstone in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Where you have been dejected and rejected before, you will be celebrated. In the name of Jesus Christ. That will be your testimony. In the mighty name of, get ready for a shocker. You can post it anywhere on social media. Let your friends know. Let somebody know. Tell your friends concerning my life, concerning my situation. Get ready for a shocker. God is turning me to a surprise to my world. And that will be your testimony in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And God sent me before you to preserve your posterity on the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Verse 8, so now it was not you that sent me here. There is a divine script, there is a divine orchestration, a divine manipulation that is at play. You are not the one that sent me here, but God, and he has made me a father to Pharaoh. Hallelujah. Let me just round up. I'm coming back. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and the Lord of all his house and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. What a contrast. Haste ye and go up to my father and say unto him, say to him, let him know that his son Joseph, his son Joseph, God has made him to be Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me and tarry not. Hallelujah. What a contrast. In the first place where we read, the Bible says he was sold for 20 pieces of silver. I've shared with you before on one of the broadcasts of Church on the Waves that when there was famine in Samaria, the Bible says the head of an ass, that is the head of a donkey, was selling for 80 pieces of silver. Joseph was not worth more than 20 pieces of silver, one quarter of what the head of a donkey was going for. Wow. That is how, that was the worth of Joseph. That was the worth of Joseph as at Genesis 37 when they sold him to slavery. Look at that same Joseph and look at this chapter 45. And the Bible says that he told them, move near to me. God has made me a father unto Pharaoh. Oh my God. God is going to give someone a contrasting testimony, an amazing testimony. He said, I will do something in your days that if you were told, you will not believe. If not that it happened to you and you saw it by yourself, you will not believe. I pray for someone son under the sound of my voice tonight, God will give you that kind of testimony. The kind that if you were told, if they told you before now, before it happens, you would never believe it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Imagine somebody who slept in the prison the night before, with all his beers and everything still intact, you know, just the chief prisoner. And then within seconds, he was sent for, he interpreted the dream, and Pharaoh stood up and said, only in the throne will I be higher than you. By your word shall my people be judged and ruled in Egypt. And removed his ring and gave it to him, removed his robe, gave it to him, told them to give him the second fastest chariot. And he said, only in position, only in title will I be higher than you. What kind of contrasting difference? What kind of contrasting miracle? I pray for someone again under the sound of my voice. God will turn you to a wonder to your world. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I remember my story some years back. You know, my mom used to have a kiosk. I mean a kiosk, not a shop. A kiosk by the roadside. Many of you probably have lived in Nigeria before, you know what the measurement of a kiosk is. The kiosk is probably not bigger than this table. That is how big, as it were, the kiosk was. My mother had a kiosk. I was helping her to sell at the kiosk. I was selling, you know, soft drinks. I was selling biscuits and sweets. I was selling, you know, detergents. I was selling crates of drinks and all of that. And I could remember in those days, those water that you put in a polythene bag, you would call it polythene bag, we used to call it nylon in those days, transparent nylon, you measure it, you put a filter, you know, you put a foam inside the filter to filter the water, and then you tie it, just selling for one naira. You know, you have to freeze it, make sure it's cold and all of that. That is where I was. That is where I was. And in that same neighborhood, we had a professor. He was a professor at the University of Ibadan, and his children, you know, were living with him in the house, very big house, beautiful house. I appreciate him, and whatever testimony I'm sharing, I'm not pulling down anyone. He was a very nice man, and his children too were very, very kind, you know. But one of his children, I could remember then, would stop by at the kiosk. He used to drive a car. He would stop by. I would run to go and meet him. What do you want? Oh, I want this number of soft drinks. Oh, we don't have as many as that in the kiosk now. Let me quickly run to the house. I'll run to the house, go and open the freezer, pick out the bottles, run to go and meet him. If he says this one is not cold enough, I don't want this one again, I want this other brand, then I run back, doing all of that. That is where I was when God granted me admission to study medicine at the University of Ibadan. I could remember it came to a day I crossed over to UCH, to the glory of God, as the clinical side of studying medicine at the College of Medicine, University of Ibadan. And then he was walking by, he was about 2 years my senior in medical school. And then he was walking past with one of his friends, and then he saw me. I could see the wonder on his face. I could see the amazement. He looked at me like 3 times. Ah, is this not the guy? Glory to God. Is this not the guy that used to run around to bring the bottles of soft drinks? You will call it soda in the US. You know, you run around to go and bring bottles of soda that we want to buy, or bottles of soft drinks, or run around to bring, you know, cold water and all of that for us. He couldn't believe it. He couldn't believe it. He couldn't believe it. I pray for someone under the sound of my voice. God will give you an amazing lift. God will give you an amazing promotion that if you were told, you would never have believed it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, God will surprise you. God will surprise you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. So you can begin to imagine the same Joseph that was not worth more than 20 pieces of silver was now king over Egypt, was now lord over the house of Pharaoh, was now a father unto Pharaoh. And it was proven, because when his brothers came, Pharaoh said, God has made you a father to me. Anywhere in the land you want to put them there. It's okay by me. Put them in any part of the land. Let them occupy. If there are farmers amongst them, let them even take care of my own livestock too. That was how much power. The Bible says there was no food in Egypt. Egyptians were selling themselves to become slaves of Pharaoh in order to eat. But the Bible says that Joseph was nourishing his brothers with the resources of Egypt. He was nourishing his brothers when Egypt was famishing in hunger and famine. They were being famished by hunger and famine, and yet Joseph was nourishing his own brothers with the resources of the same Egypt. Come to think of it, when he interpreted the dream, it could have been good enough for Pharaoh to say, oh, thank you, my son. Oh, so you are indeed lied again. So you didn't commit, you know, what the crime that you were put in prison for. Oh, I will punish Potiphar. Don't worry. I'll punish Potiphar and I'll punish his wife. Take some, maybe 20 bags of silver or whatever it is, and then please, you can go back to your father. That would have sufficed. That would have been enough reward for interpreting the dream. But why did he become the king of Egypt, as it were, the prime minister of Egypt? And he was the one ruling by his words where all Egyptians ruled. What did it take for him to transform from that level to where he came to be by Genesis 45 from verse 1 to 8? That is what I want to share with you today. What is it that will transform a man from slavery, from servanthood to rulership? What will transfer a man from commonness to greatness? What will transfer a man from nonentity to celebrity? What will transfer a man from a nobody to a somebody? What will transfer a man from a zero to a hero? What will transfer a man from ground zero to the highest heights of life? What does it take for a man to change levels like that? What does it take for a man to change levels like that? It takes two things. Some years ago, I was meditating on this passage of scripture on the life of Joseph, and God gave me a word. He said, you know what? He said, Joseph left home naked. Joseph left home naked. When his brothers were going to put him in the pit, they removed his coat of many colors. They stained it with the blood of an animal, and they lied to their father that a wild animal had killed him. So he left home naked. Maybe they just gave him a piece of cloth to cover his private part. That was all they left him with. Joseph left home naked. But do you know what? Joseph did not leave home empty. Joseph did not leave home empty. Joseph left with at least two things. And that is what I want to share with you tonight. If you have those two things, you will get to the highest throne in life. If you have those two things working for you, there's no height you cannot ascend to in life. And if you have been looking at yourself, looking down at yourself, maybe, you know, I'm a nobody. No, nobody really celebrates me. Everybody despises me. Rejoice, because that qualifies you for God's lifting. That qualifies you for God's lifting. He said, you know your calling, brethren. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I believe from verse 26. He said, you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise after the flesh, not many noble, not many mighty were called, but God has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the strong. He has chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. He has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the strong. He has chosen the things that are despised, things that have no reckoning, to confound those things that are being celebrated. And he now ended with a statement. He said, he does it this way so that no flesh, no man will glory in his presence, so that no man will glory in his presence. God is the number one master script writer. Look at this story. When I look at the story of Joseph and look at the story of someone like Esther, you know, I understand that God is the master script writer. Look at it. Somebody that was not worth more than 20 pieces of silver, and in just 8 chapters down the line, was now father. The Bible says, by that the Ishmaelites brought him to Egypt. And then look at the contrasting thing. In the same Egypt where it was Ishmaelites that brought him as a servant, as a slave, and sold him probably to Potiphar, it was in the same Egypt that he now became a father to Pharaoh and lord over all his house. Hallelujah. That is what God can do. God is the master script writer. He has written a script concerning you. And most of the people that he writes script about or that qualifies for his lifting are people who are already down. You know, when we're growing up, there was a term people used to refer us as. They used to call us Oma Akarateko, you know, because, you know, we took a lot of pap and akara. Akara is bean cake, for those who might not know what it is, who might not be Nigerians, but bean cake and pap. That is what we're described as. You don't despise those people because that is where you were. But that, by his grace, qualified you for a lift. So if you are being ridiculed today, if you are being despised today, don't mind them. If you are being described, that brother with that red shirt is always wearing that red shirt. That's the only shirt he has. Oh, that lady that is not yet married. Are you being described by your situation and your circumstances? Oh, that lady that is old enough but not yet married. Oh, that lady that has been married for so number of years but doesn't have a child yet. Don't blame them. Don't fight them, because that is truly where you are now. But the beautiful thing about our God is that God does not call you, or God does not see you as you are right now. He sees you as you can be. He sees you as he has designed you to be. Look at Abraham. When he had no child, God changed his name from Abraham to Abraham, father of many nations. Everybody was looking at him and said, this man doesn't have a child. God was looking at the nations. Look at the nations that Abraham has now. At least the five major religions in the world attribute Abraham as their father. You talk about Christianity, you talk about Islam, you talk about Hindu, you know, those who practice Hindu, you talk about all the other, some other Judaism and all those other things, they regard Abraham as their father. Truly, he has become the father of many nations. So don't let anybody despise, that is why Paul told Timothy, don't let anybody despise your youth. Don't let anybody's description of you now make you to be depressed or make you to be dejected or make you to be discouraged. No, let them describe you that way, because it qualifies you for a lift from God. That is why Micah 7:8 says, my enemy rejoice not over me, for when I fall, I will rise again. And when I sit in darkness, then God will shine his light unto me. Hallelujah. God does it in a way that only him will take the glory at the end of the day. So if you are down there, then you qualify for his lift. Don't be discouraged that you are down. Don't be depressed that you are down. Don't lose hope because you are down. Know that God has orchestrated that for a lifting for you. And I pray for everyone who may be down right now. You are depressed. You are dejected. You know, you are confused. You've given up on yourself. No, don't give up. I pray for you today, by this word coming your way, God will lift you up. In the mighty name, and you know it's the Most High. When he lifts you up, you will be seen by all. God will turn you to a city set upon thee that cannot be hid. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Remember, God will shock you to your bones. God will surprise you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. So what does it take to rise from commonness to greatness? It takes two things. The first thing is divine presence. And that was all that Joseph had, divine presence. If you look at Genesis 39 from verse 2, the Bible says, and the Lord was with Joseph, and God made him to prosper. And the Bible says that his master Potiphar saw that God was with him, and that because of him, God has blessed him. The Bible says both what Potiphar had at home and what Potiphar had in the field. Despite the fact that Joseph was not working on the field, he was a domestic staff, he was working in the house, but he carried divine presence, which we call the blessing. He carried divine presence, and that made the difference. He rubbed on what Potiphar had at home. It rubbed on what Potiphar had in the field. So Potiphar's business, Potiphar's enterprise, Potiphar's outlets were flourishing just because there was a Joseph at home. And the Bible says even when Potiphar's wife lied against him and they put him in prison, even in the prison, the Bible says, and the Lord was with Joseph and granted him favor before the keeper of the prison. And all the activities of the prison were handed over to Joseph, so that anything that was done in the prison, it was Joseph that was accounted to have done it. Hallelujah. So he had divine presence. I've shared with you before on this platform not too long ago on the power or the wonders of divine presence, when I shared on one thing. So I won't really go too far into that. Divine presence guarantees favor. Divine presence guarantees victory. Divine presence subdues obstacles on your path. Divine presence makes things to be easy for you. And I pray for someone today, the same God that was with Joseph, that turned him from a slave to a ruler, will be with you all the days of your life. He will never leave you nor forsake you, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. How to focus on the second thing that Joseph left home with. Joseph left home with divine presence. Remember, he was naked, but he was not empty. He was not empty. And one of my spiritual fathers was saying it, that there was a time he was checking in into a country and they asked him at the airport, what do you have in the bag? He told them, what do you have? And they told him, is this all that you have? And he told them, no. And they were wondering, what else do you have? And he told them, what is here? And what is here is more than all 200 boxes put together. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So Joseph left home as it were naked, but he did not leave home empty. He left with divine presence. The second thing that Joseph left home with is that Joseph left home with a dream. Joseph left home with a dream. And that is what I want to focus on tonight on this broadcast of Church on the Waves. Do you have a dream? Do you have a dream? What is a dream? I'm not talking about just sleeping and having a dream. If you were hungry and you slept off, you probably dream about food. If you have missed someone before and you were thinking about him before you slept off, you probably see him in your dreams. You know, so many things. I'm not talking about the human dream or the regular dream that we have from time to time. What is a dream? A dream is a God-given picture of the future. A God-given picture of the future. A God-given picture of the future. And if you don't have a picture of the future, you can never feature in the future. I repeat, if you don't have a picture of the future, you can never feature in the future. You need a God-given dream of the future. That is what a dream is. A God-given, not fantasy. Not just sitting down and then wondering and then dreaming, like I said. Or maybe you were hungry and then you slept and found yourself in a restaurant and then they served you. Eat all you can and then you are eating and all of that. Some people have had some kind of dreams and they woke up finding out that they've eaten their pillows. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That's not the kind of dream I'm talking about. I'm talking about a God-given picture of the future. You need it. If you are going to rise from commonness to greatness, servanthood to rulership, if you are going to rise from zero to hero, if you are going to rise from nothing to something, if you are going to rise from nobody to somebody, you need to have those two things in life. If you have a dream and you have a God on your side, you will rise to the top in life. A God-given picture of the future. And it comes from the Holy Ghost. Joel chapter 2 verse 28, he said, behold, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. He said, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy. He said, your old men will dream dreams and your young men will see visions. They will see visions. A picture of the future, you need it. Because if you don't have a picture of the future, you can never feature in the future. How do I know? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, the Bible says, being encompassed about with this great no cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and every yoke, that every sin that does it beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. And now said in verse 2, looking unto Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him, he despised the cross, he endured the cross, he despised the shame. And now there's laid before him, he's seated now at the right hand of the throne of God. He's now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. So when he was being nailed to the cross, when they were beating him with 39 stripes, when they were flogging him, when they were beating him with everything, he had a picture of the future in mind. He saw a picture of the future. And that is why the Bible says in Philippians chapter 2 verse 9, God has highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every name must bow, of things in heaven. Do you know, if I mention God now, the angels will not bow. But if I mention Jesus, both things in heaven, things on earth, and things underneath the earth, every knee bows to the authority of Jesus. For the joy that was set before him, he had a picture of the future. That is why he could feature in the future. You can exchange dream and say interchangeably and use vision for it. You need to have a vision. You need to have a vision, a picture of the future that will guarantee you featuring in the future. Remember, I've told you that life is a script. The whole of life is like a stage. Life is like a theater stage. We are all actors in this life. You need to have a glimpse. You need to have a picture of that future. If you are going to feature, F-E-A-T-U-R-E, in the future, F-U-T-U-R-E. You need to have a picture of the future before you can feature in the future. So a dream is a God-given picture of the future, and it comes from the Holy Ghost. That is the authentic dream. That is the one that will come to pass. That is the one that cannot be denied. That is the one that cannot be resisted. That is the one that will surely come to pass. What is it about a dream? Number one, your dream is what will separate you from among every other person. You look at what Joseph told his brothers in Genesis 37, verse 7. He said, we're all on the field, we're gathering the sheaves. And he said, and my sheaves stood up. Hallelujah. My sheaves stood up among all the other sheaves. And your own sheaves bowed down to my own sheaves. And his brother said, he said, for behold, Genesis 37, verse 7, he said, for behold, we are binding sheaves in the field. And lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaf stood round about it and made obeisance, that is, bowed down to my sheaf. And his brother said to him, ah, shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you have dominion over us? And they hated him the more for his dream. And yet he dreamed another dream and told his brethren, verse 9, behold, I dreamed a dream. And behold, the sun, the moon, and 11 stars, they made obeisance to me. They bowed to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren. And his father rebuked him and said unto him, what is this dream that you have dreamt? Shall I and your mother and your brethren indeed bow down ourselves to you, to the earth, to you? Verse 11, his brethren envied him, but his father observed his saying. Do you know why? Because his father knows that dreams come true. Why? His father also had a dream when he was running away in Genesis 28 from his brother when Esau promised to kill him. Anywhere I see Jacob, I'm going to kill him. Genesis 28, he had a dream. He saw a ladder extending from heaven to earth. And angels were ascending and descending on the ladder, and God was on top of that ladder. He was lying on a stone. He was using stone for a pillow. And God told him, I'm the God of your father, Abraham and Isaac. Anywhere you go, I will go with you. The land where you are lying on with stone, I will give it to your seed and give it to your children. The same thing about Joseph. You know, the land where you were sold in as a slave, I will give it to you and make you Lord over the whole of Egypt. I will make you father to Pharaoh. Isn't that what the same thing that God told Jacob? He said, this land where you are lying upon, the only thing you have now, property you have now, is a stone that you are using as a pillow. How comfortable would that have been? He said, that same land, I'm going to give it to you and to your seed. I will bring you back to this place. And no wonder he said in Genesis 32, verse 10, he said, I bless the God of my father, Abraham and Isaac. He said, because with a rod, with one rod, one stick, I crossed this Jordan. He said, but now that I'm coming back, I have become two bands. That is, I cannot even move in one company. I cannot move in one group. We are so large, we are so rich, we are so blessed that we have to be in two divided groups. Two divided groups. He said, I crossed this Jordan with one rod. He said, but now I have become two bands. It takes a dreamer to understand a dreamer. When Jacob had the story or the dreams of Joseph, he knew that this thing will come to pass. He rebuked him in the presence of his brother, so I don't mean that he was a partial father, but he knew that this guy has found a ticket that will separate him from the rest of his brethren. He said, my sheep stood up and then stood upright, and your own sheaves bowed down to my own sheaves. A dream is what will separate you from common men. That is why you need a dream. And if God has given you a dream, you must never trade your dream, because that is your ticket from commonness to greatness. You can't afford to trade your dreams. You can't afford to sell your dream. That is all you have. That is all you have. I hope somebody is feeling the passion in my voice today. Don't sell your dream. That is your ticket from commonness to greatness. That is what will separate you from your brethren. In Genesis 49, by the time Isaac was blessing, Jacob was blessing his sons. Look at what he said concerning Joseph in Genesis 49, very popular scripture. Many of us know it. Look at what he said. It is a dream that will separate you from every other person. It is what will separate you from the common man, from the common people, and give you a distinction in life. Genesis 49 from verse 22. Joseph is a fruitful bough, even a fruitful bough by a well, whose branches run over the wall. The archers have sorely grieved him and shot at him and hated him, but his bow are bold in strength, and the arm of his bands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From thence is the shepherd, the stone of Israel, even by the God of your father, who shall help you. Hallelujah. Remember, help from above. And by the Almighty, who shall bless you. Remember the blessing. With the blessings of heaven above, blessings of the deep. I thought somebody would be saying amen. Blessings that lieth under, blessings of the breast and blessings of the womb. The blessings of your father has prevailed or superseded the blessings of my progenitors. That is, your blessing has surpassed the blessing of even my own fathers or your own grandfathers and great-grandfathers. Unto the utmost bound of the everlasting hills, they shall be on the head of Joseph and on the crown of the head of him that was separated from his brethren. What separated him from his brethren? He had a dream. His other brethren did not have a dream. He was the only one among the 12 sons of Jacob that had a dream. A dream is what will separate you from the rest. A dream, you need to have a dream. You need to have a dream. You need to have a dream. That is what will separate you from common men. That is what will give you your own place. The Bible says something in Proverbs chapter 17, verse 18. A gift is like a precious stone. A man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men. That is what a dream is. It's like a gift, a grace upon your life. It is what will bring you before great men. It is what will make room for you in life. Somebody said, no matter how crowded the place is, there is always room. There is always space for the man that knows where he's going. If you know where you are going, no matter how crowded the place is, you will find your way. You can imagine if there is a queue, a mammoth crowd gathering somewhere, and you tell somebody, please excuse me. The first thing they will ask you is, where are you going to? We are all crowded here. We are all crowded. Me too. He said, please excuse me. Please excuse me. Before you know it, everybody will start making way for you. When you know where you are going, there will always be room for you. A dream, a gift is like a precious stone. Proverbs 18, verse 16. In the house of him that has it, wheresoever it turneth, it prospereth. I pray for someone today. God will give you a God-given dream that will open doors for you in life. I will make room for you in life in the mighty name. You will rise to the top. That dream will come to pass. It will not fail. The Bible says they hated Joseph. They shot at him. They actually shot at him, but yet his bows multiplied. When you catch a God-given picture of the future, which is a dream, everything everybody else will be doing as it were against you will be actually be working out in your favor. That is the power of a dream. Look at what Jacob said. He said the archers hated him. That is referring to Joseph. They shot at him. They made every attempt to make sure. Remember when they were selling him, what did they say? They said, there comes the dreamer. He said, let's kill him and let's see what will become of his dreams. What will become of his dreams? Little did they know that once God has given a young man, a young woman, a young boy, a young girl, a given picture of the future, there's nothing you can do against it. You look at Christ also, when they were nailing him to the cross, they were fulfilling the things that were written concerning him. Hallelujah. When God gives you a vision of the future, a dream, nobody can resist it. The Bible says there's nothing we can do against the truth but for the truth. That means everything, even if they intended it to work against you, it will be working in your favor. That is why he told them in that 45 verse 5, don't be grieved in your heart that you sold me to Egypt. You did not sell me to Egypt. God sent me ahead of you to preserve your lives. Do you have a dream? Hallelujah. What else is about the dream? I don't think I'll be able to finish today. I will continue on the next broadcast of Church on the Waves. But let me just see if I can still talk on one or two more points. What is it about a dream? Remember what I've said, it is a picture of the future. And without a picture of the future, you can never feature in the future. What else is it about a dream? Your dream is your ticket from commonness to greatness. It is your ticket from commonness to greatness. It is your ticket from commonness to greatness. Remember, Joseph was not worth more than 20 pieces of silver by the time they were selling him. But he entered that same Egypt with those two things. He entered with a God or a divine presence, and he entered with a dream. If you go anywhere, even if you are in Malawi, even if you are in Zimbabwe, even if you are in Morocco, anywhere, even if you are in the desert part of the earth, if you have God there with you and you have a dream, you will rise to the top. You will rise to the top. Remember, just look at the contrast. Look back at Joseph. What did he enter Egypt with? Nothing. He had nothing attached to his name. He had nothing in reference to his name. He had nothing to point to. No bank account, no property. He entered Egypt naked. But did not enter Egypt empty. Your dream is your ticket from commonness to greatness. Remember when they sold him for 20 pieces of silver, the Bible says, and the Ishmaelites brought him to Egypt. When you have a vision, a God-given picture of the future, that is what will take you from the Egypt of life, or take you from the commonness of life to greatness. That is what will take you from commonness to greatness. That is what will be your ticket. You know, he couldn't pay for the fear by himself, but because they had sold him as a slave, he got a free ride to Egypt to go and emerge as the prince of Egypt, to go and emerge as the prime minister of Egypt. I pray for someone today, God will lift you up in a dramatic way beyond your calculations, beyond your estimations, beyond you know, beyond your fasting and prayer. God will lift you up today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. He will lift you to heights you have never imagined. God will shock you to your bones. God will surprise you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And I say big amen to that even for myself. Hallelujah. What is it about a dream? Hallelujah. What you see is what you become. What you see is what you become. What you see is what you become. In the secular world, they say what you see is what you get. It is very true. It is what you see that you will get. I was telling someone recently, I said, life is a buffet. God showed me that many years ago, because Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Some people were lame. They met him and they began to walk. Some had leprosy. They met him and they were healed of their leprosy. Some had their children dead and then they met him and then their children were raised back to life. And God told me, life is a buffet. Life is a buffet. Life does not give you what you deserve. Life gives you what you demand. And whatever you demand from life, if it is a God-given picture of the future, life will supply you. Life cannot resist you. Somebody calls it, refers to it as the universe. The universe, all the forces at play will work to deliver your God-given vision of the picture, or picture of the future. Your God deliver your dream to you. That is the way life is. What you behold or what you have dreamt, the picture of what you see is what you will become. Do you know that where you are now is what you saw yesterday? I was sharing with someone recently and I referred to that. I look back at my life. Where I am now is what I talked about yesterday. Many, many years ago, I don't think I didn't enter the university then. I used to tell myself that in the nearest future, and then, you know, one boots climbing one place. Even when I got admission to study electrical engineering, on my welcome package, I wrote my name as Dr. Gbenga Adulojaye. What you see is what you will become. Life will give you what you demand. Life will give you what you demand. So what dreams do you have? What picture of the future do you have? The universe will organize itself to deliver it to you. And that will be your testimony in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Remember when Lot had been separated from Abraham, God called Abraham out in Genesis 13. And he told him, he said, Abraham, Look, come, let me show you something. Genesis 13, let me just quickly read it to you. Hallelujah. I don't want to paraphrase it, you know, for you. Genesis 13 from verse 14, as I round up. And the Lord said unto Abraham, after Lot was separated from me, lift up now your eyes and look from the place where you are. Look northward, look southward, look eastward, look westward. Why? All the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to your seed forever. The limitation to what you will have is what you see. The limitation to what you will have, Abraham, is not the size of the land. The limitation, God is endless. There is nothing. God, you can't embarrass God with your request. You can't embarrass God with your dream. There's no dream you can ever have. Oh, no. If he has given you a picture of the future, there's no dream too big for our God to accomplish. God told him, Abraham, and I will be right. See, that is, so you are left to yourself. You are the one that will determine what you will get. So if I ask you, my friend, today, what do you see? Concerning yourselfness, or do you see commonness? What do you see? Do you see rulership, or do you see slavery? What do you see? Do you see stardom, or you see suffering? What do you see? Do you see commonness, or you see greatness? What do you see? Do you can see? I will give it to you. I need to round up here today, and it's paining me, but we'll continue on the next broadcast of Church on the Waves. I'd like somebody to pray a prayer with me. I saw something many years ago in the book of Psalms. Hallelujah. In the book of Psalms, he said, open thou my eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. I want somebody to talk to God in prayer right now and say, Lord, open my eyes to see. Open my eyes to see. He said to Abraham, as far as your eyes can see, I will give it to you. Open my eyes to see, give me a picture of the future so that I can feature in the future. I don't want to live life a non-entity. I don't want to live life a zero. I don't want to live a life of commonness. I want to live the life of greatness that you have designed. It will surely come to pass. No matter the many archers shooting at you and how much they hate you, your dream will still be fulfilled. The same God of Joseph will be your God. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, you will fulfill that vision. You will fulfill that dream. You will fulfill that divine mandate. In the name of Jesus, you will rise to the throne. You will rise to the throne. You will rise to the top. In the name of Jesus Christ, you will not end life in slavery. You will not end life in slavery. You will end up in the palace. In the name of Jesus Christ, the God of Joseph will be your God. He will lift up your head. He said, many there be that say of my soul, there is no hope for him in God. He said, but thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory, and the lift up of my head. I pray for you today, God will be a shield to you. God will be your glory and the lift up of your head. He will lift up your head today. You will rise to stardom. You will rise to greatness. The God will shock you with that promotion, an amazing promotion. In the name of Jesus Christ, God will surprise you. God will amaze you. God will daze you. In the name of Jesus Christ, and so shall it be in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to pray for you, my friend. He's having a relationship with God that will give you a dream, that will give you a vision. You are out there. You don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. It was after I gave my life to Christ that God gave me a picture of the future. And I tell you, that picture is being fulfilled today, day by day, day by day. I can't, because of time, I can't go, you know, in depth into a lot of things today. So if you are out there, you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, He can give you a dream from today. I would like you to say this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I come to you today, realizing that only you can give me a ticket out of commonness to greatness. Lord Jesus, I repent of all my sins today. I ask that you forgive me and wash me clean with your precious blood. From today, I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. Congratulations. I pray that the grace of God will keep you and uphold you to the very end. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want to thank everyone who joined us today on this platform. Please share this video. I'll go and watch it again and listen. This was a word from heaven, and I believe it will bless someone. Share this video. Share the podcast when you get the audio. Share it with your friends. Start a watch party. Share it on all the platforms that you have. I'm sure somebody will be inspired. Somebody will be blessed by this message, and they will remember you for life for sharing this with them. Once again, your dream will come to pass. We'll continue, don't worry, on the next broadcast of Church on the Waves. It's burning inside of me as if I should continue, but we need to round up here. I will continue on the next broadcast of Church on the Waves. This is awesome. This is inspiring. This is highly motivating. This is awesome. Share it with your friends and let it be a blessing to them. See all our social media platforms are streaming live there. We've opened another YouTube channel for the Script Ministry. That is the YouTube channel. All the videos will be uploaded there. Please subscribe to that YouTube channel. And then all the videos of the past editions of Church on the Waves and the patterns will be uploaded on that platform. Listen to them again. Watch them again. Be inspired by them. I believe the fire in this message will keep you to the next broadcast of Church on the Waves. God bless you and keep you, and cause His face to shine upon you. Go out there and fulfill your dreams. Rise to the top. God will surprise you. God will shock you to the bones, and you will laugh at last in Jesus' name. Congratulations. God bless you. I'll see you next time. Bye.